This is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope. AWR
Ghana. Voice of Hope. Voice of
Hope. This is Daylight Magazine, and under this segment, we have Reflections,
Youth Corner,
and Moment of Truth.
I am Kwejo Ansedu, and I'm presenting this with
Hannah B. Nyakun.
How are you doing today, Hannah?
I'm doing well, and you?
I'm doing well as well. I hope, dear listener, you enjoy our programs. Stay tuned.
AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope. Voice of Hope. When they're not around.
Of all the things to do to a friend, you hurt them by your tongue. Relationships will fatally end without a knife or gun. Waiting till you're back behind them, then you put them down. How could you be talking about them when they're not?
Talking about friends when they're not around. When they're not around. When they're not around.
All the gossip falls on our ears. It doesn't make much sense when we can cause the innocent tears, not helping their defense. Listening. We all should feel it. Listening is wrong. If there were no one to hear
it could not go on. Don't be talking about friends when they're not around. Don't be cutting their hearts and putting them down. Don't be tempting the Lord and making him frown. Talking about friends when they're not around. When they're not around. When they're not around.
Oh, do you have a mirror image? I hope you do. Come join me as we take a purposeful contemplation of our lives. This is the program Reflection.
Once upon a time, Mr. Badger wanted to build a dam, but had never done so before. Wise Mr. Owl suggested that he seek Mr. Beaver, who was the world's best dam builder. So he did. Mr. Beaver gave him all the advice he needed. Then Mr. Badger got to work. After a lot of hard work, Mr. Badger had his very own dam. Something he could be proud of. And all because of Mr. Beaver's good advice. Whenever a person desires to make a breakthrough in an area of his life, he has to exert energy against the inertia and obstacles that impede his progress. Advancement will occur if good plans are established. These are made by seeking advice and information from others. Before you declare war on an area of your life you wish to improve, gain all the counsel you can. Then, put that counsel into action and go for it, because plans succeed through good counsel. Don't go to war without the advice of others. God bless you.
This segment is about the youth and their lives in today's world. The program is Youth Corner.
Aimlessly beneath the barren sky, leave it to me, I lead you home. So afraid that you will not be found, it won't be long before your sun goes down. Just leave it to me, I'll lead you home.
Hello, thank you so much for joining us, dear listener. This is another edition of Youth Corner. My name is Alfred Niamakeke, and I'm here with Randolph Efrifananowari and Peter Manson. We are continuing with our discussion on Titan. Randolph, what do you think should be the case? Should tithes necessarily go to the church alone or solely, or it can go outside the church to orphanages in the form of alms to the poor or the needy? Can that be done?
Well, from the biblical perspective, tithe is not a gift. Tithe is the Lord's. You give it to God, and it is not our responsibility to give tithe to the needy. You can choose to give something else or something from your own heart to someone as a gift or to the needy, but the tithe belongs to God. The tithe, it is you acknowledging that He is the owner. So if something you are supposed to give to the owner, like you've been sent to take this envelope, go and give it to maybe your mom, and you meet someone on the way, and your mom's envelope, which you have money in, because you have seen a needy or someone who needs something, you open the envelope and you give the money to the one who is in need. When you go home, what will be the question? It doesn't show respect. That means the tithe is the Lord's. It's for somebody. It is God's. And so you give it to the person, and maybe you tell the person, oh, there's someone who is in need here. So that is the job of the church. If the church sees someone in need in the church and they want to help, well, the tithe has a whole role to play. The church is supposed to use that in paying the clergy or the pastors, and also making good things in the church. So the tithe is not a gift.
All right, well understood. Can you give more than 10%?
Oh, yes, it depends on you. God says, I need 10% from you. So if you give 10% and you think you have more to give, fine.
Would it come with an extra spiritual advantage in terms of the blessings?
Oh, for that, biblically, I've never seen something like that. But it is your own something that you want to do.
What about personally?
You do what?
Have you had a personal experience?
Oh, no, my brother.
Where you have given more than 10%?
Okay, I pay tithe and offering. So maybe adding the offering will maybe say I'm giving more than what I am giving, but it still doesn't fall under tithe. The tithe is 10%. So if you give more, that is just an offering.
Can you give more than the 10%? And what would be the advantage or otherwise?
Regarding the advantage of giving more, I think that one, perhaps God can be the only one to determine.
Yes.
Maybe the blessings or the benefits when you give more than 10%. But from the biblical point of view, whatever God tells us to do or instructs us to do is kind of enough for us.
Yeah.
So if you just stick to that one, it's enough. However, there are instances where you want to, let's say, give to the poor, orphanages, all these things are kind of giving aside the tithes. And yeah. I think if you do that, it's also okay.
All right. I have heard before someone argue, or people really argue, that obedience, I mean, using the biblical basis, that obedience is better than sacrifice. God has his own reason for some of these spiritual and biblical principles. Yeah. And once he has said that you should give 10%, you shouldn't give less or more. Giving less means breaking it. Giving more means breaking it. What would you say to that?
Like Randolph was saying, if you are giving more than the 10%, then it's like you are paying the tithe plus offering.
Yeah.
Anything aside the 10% is offering.
Okay, interesting. But how really should it go in this perspective? I mean, still talking about tithing. Can you decide that this month I'm supposed to pay 50 cedis, or let's say $50 or whatever currency, but because of some financial constraints, I'll postpone it to next month. And next month, instead of paying 50, I'll spend 25 out of the 50 this month and pay the 25 as an extra to the 50 I'm supposed to pay next month, making it $75 or cedis. Can you postpone it so that it will be like you owe God some?
We cannot owe God. There's one Bible quotation I'm even looking for. It says, if you refuse to pay it, or you use the money for something, the next time you are coming to pay, you have to add 5% of that very amount. Biblically, yes, it's in the Bible. I read it early this morning, but I forgot to put the text down. You are supposed to pay 5% plus. It's like, even now, you have to just sacrifice and pay it now, and you do the rest. But we always think about the problems. If we always think about what we are going to benefit and leave God, we always lose. But if we see God first and give whatever he requires from us, he will take care of us. So it's not best, because it will still affect you.
Peter?
Postponing tithe and paying it later is not a very wise idea as a Christian. The first thing you ought to do when you receive your salary is to just pay your tithe and be free.
Yeah.
Don't kind of postpone it, settle other things, pursue your other pleasurable things, and come and think, oh, I should have paid this. No. And some of these things could also happen because we are living beyond our means, or we set very extremely high targets for ourselves. The Bible tells us that godliness with contentment is what? Great gain. Mm-hmm. You get it? Godliness is not the means to financial. So just live within your means, cut your coat according to your size, pay your tithe the first thing, then think of what to do with the rest.
On that point of godliness being the contentment of, what is that, did you say?
Godliness with contentment is great gain.
What does that mean?
Meaning that being godly per se is not an avenue to make a lot of resources or get rich. However, if you are godly and you are content with whatever God has given you, no matter how small it is, God appreciates that.
Where do you pay your tithes? Can it be in another church? Maybe you visit a church outside, you wait to come back. For someone who travels often, do you wait to come back, then you pay your tithe, or what?
That's an interesting question. Well, you know, a lot of churches now have branches.
Yeah.
So if you find yourself in a different location by the same church, that's different branch, you can pay it there. Yeah. Otherwise, if you are in a different geographical location, you can pay it wherever you fellowship.
Yeah. All right. So on that note, we end this edition of Youth Corner. My name is Afrenia Makeke. I've been here with Randolph Efrifa Nanowari and Peter Mensah. This brings us to the end of our discussion on Titan. Thank you for joining us.
World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope. AWR. Voice.
sorrowful, we will bring you joy. Keep hope alive.
You can contact us on
Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058.
Not with all that I'm gonna be. Spirits living inside of me. Can't improve on my family tree. Spirits living inside of me. All of my life,
He needs to guide.
All of my life.
Given me, I am not what I used to be. Since He came into my heart to dwell, everybody can tell.
Best is yet that I'm gonna see.
Spirits living inside of me.
Can't improve on my destiny.
Spirits living inside of me.
All of my life,
He needs to guide.
All of my life.
Spirit, I am now His home, in His comfort not to be alone, here to guide me and to intercede. He's providing all I need.
Living inside.
Not with all that I'm gonna be.
Spirits living inside of me. Can't improve on my family tree. Spirits living inside of me.
All of my life.
Cherished listener, this is the moment of truth, where truth is presented with precision and exactness. Enjoy this encounter of a lifetime.
You are once again listening to Moment of Truth, and your speaker this hour is Pastor Odumse Ekweokunyantechi of Valley View University. We started off the other day talking about Cain and how he treated his brother Abel, and we reached a point where the emphasis was on the value of human life, and truly we have lost touch of human value. It's my prayer that as we listen to the second section of this series, the Almighty God will impress His truth upon our minds, and that we will be humble and put other people's interests first and foremost, as Jesus said. Today, human life is losing its value because of selfishness, greed for money and power, hatred and pride. Human life can be readily exchanged for political power, position, or riches. Think about Sakawa. The Ghanaians understand what Sakawa is. People who want to be rich overnight, selling themselves into spiritism, and then having to decide to go by certain demands made by these psychics. You have to stay in the coffin overnight and all kinds of horrible things. Some people don't even have to take a bath. If you do, you die. And they are given a period of time to live their lives. None of these strange restrictions will prevent them from going for money. The Bible says riches is the root, or money is the root of all evil. Where have the Sakawa people placed human value? Where is your brother Abel? Fellow believers, it is not all about Sakawa and murder, as we emphasized the other time. Being our brother's keeper is more about relationships. Please turn with me to Matthew chapter 5, verse 21 and 24. Matthew 5, 21 and 24. Let's hear the word of God. You have heard that it was said to the people long ago, "Do not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you that anyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to his brother, 'Raka,' is answerable to the Sanhedrin. But anyone who says, 'You fool,' will be in danger of the fire of hell. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to your brother. Then come and offer your gift." Here, Jesus highlights Cain's action in a broader perspective. What does it tell us about our relationship with people? Do you realize how the passage mirrors our attitudes towards our brothers and sisters? Yes, it brings into focus our anger, hatred, pride, and the grudges we bear against our fellow human beings. Jesus makes two important points very clear here. Number one, hatred or contempt towards a brother leads to eternal separation from God. Bearing grudges against a brother is incompatible with worship or profession of faith. Hostility, unforgiveness, and vindictiveness do not promote Christian unity. Our worship is meaningless. If we fail to love, forgive, and treat our fellow men with respect and recognition, where is your brother? Where is that brother of yours you are crossed with? Where is that brother in whose presence you feel uncomfortable and you wish he were dead? What have you reduced that person to in your heart, in your conversation, and in your value system? Do you recognize him as a human being just as you are? Am I my brother's keeper? Cain's questions show how sin has marred human relationships. Why be my brother's keeper? Am I responsible for somebody else's welfare? And who is my brother? And this reminds me of an unusual remark once made by my younger son. At the age of 2.5, my older brother has brought home his children so that they could play together. So he said to the younger son, "Nana, I've brought your brother so that you can have fun together." Looking into his eyes and turning to his elder brother, he said emphatically, "This is my brother," pointing to his brother, trying to explain that he doesn't know his cousins and they aren't his brothers. Can you imagine an infant of his age? This tells us how sin has actually destroyed our affection, our thoughts, and our motives. For him, we took it as childlike innocence. But sin has really caused us a lot. We are estranged from people because we are not familiar with them, because they speak different language, because they belong to a different culture or different race. But God created us from the same family, Adam and Eve. It's my prayer that the Spirit of God will work on our hearts, that we would know and understand that people from all over the world are from the same God, the creator of the universe, from the same blood. May God bless you as you think in that way. Amen.
This is our address, Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058. I am blessed being a part of this program. Hannah, what about you?
The same here.
So I believe, listener, you did too. This has been once again Kwejo and Senedu and
Hannah B. Nyaku.
God bless you.